The Mysterious Mansion. About 100 yards from the town of Vendôme, on the borders of the Loire, there is an old grey house, surmounted by very high gables, and so completely isolated that neither tanyard nor shabby hostelry, such as you may find at the entrance to all small towns, exists in its immediate neighborhood. In front of this building, overlooking the river, is a garden, where the once well-trimmed box borders that used to define the walks now grow wild as they list. Several willows that spring from the Loire have grown as rapidly as the hedge that encloses it and half concealed the house. The rich vegetation of those weeds, that we call foul, adorns the sloping shore. Fruit trees, neglected for the last 10 years, no longer yield their harvest, and their shoots form coppices. The wall fruit grows like hedges against the walls. Paths, once graveled, are overgrown with moss, but, to tell the truth, there is no trace of a path. From the height of the hill to which cling the ruins of the old castle of the Dukes of Vendôme, the only spot whence the eye can plunge into this enclosure, it strikes you that, at a time not easy to determine, this plot of land was the delight of a country gentleman who cultivated roses and tulips and horticulture in general, and who was besides a lover of fine fruit. An arbor is still visible, or rather, the debris of an arbor, where there is a table that time has not quite destroyed. The aspect of this garden of bygone days suggests the negative joys of peaceful provincial life, as one might reconstruct the life of a worthy tradesman by reading the epitaph on his tombstone. As if to complete the sweetness and sadness of the ideas that possess one's soul, one of the walls displays a sundial decorated with the following commonplace Christian inscription, Ultimam Cogita. The roof of this house is horribly dilapidated. The shutters are always closed. The balconies are covered with swallows' nests. The doors are perpetually shut. Weeds have drawn green lines in the cracks of the flights of steps. The locks and bolts are rusty. Sun, moon, winter, summer, and snow have worn the paneling, warped the boards, gnawed the paint. The lugubrious silence which reigns there is only broken by birds, cats, martens, rats, and mice, free to course to and fro, to fight, and to eat each other. Everywhere an invisible hand has graven the word mystery. Should your curiosity lead you to glance at this house from the side that points to the road, you would perceive a great door, which the children of the place have riddled with holes. I afterward heard that this door had been closed for the last 10 years. Through the holes broken by the boys, you would have observed the perfect harmony that existed between the facades of both garden and courtyard. In both, the same disorder prevails. Tufts of weed encircle the paving stones. Enormous cracks furrow the walls, round whose blackened crests twine the 1,000 garlands of the pellitory. The steps are out of joint, the wire of the bell is rusted, the spouts are cracked. What fire from heaven has fallen here? What tribunal has decreed that salt should be strewn on this dwelling? Has God been blasphemed? Has France been here betrayed? These are the questions we ask ourselves, but get no answer from the crawling things that haunt the place. The empty and deserted house is a gigantic enigma, of which the key is lost. In bygone times, it was a small fief, and bears the name of the Grande Bretèque. I inferred that I was not the only person to whom my good landlady had communicated the secret, of which I was to be the sole recipient, and I prepared to listen.
"Sir," she said, "when the Emperor sent the Spanish prisoners of war and others here, the government quartered on me a young Spaniard who had been sent to Vendôme on parole."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.